It's Wednesday night, and we are in a study on how to rest in everything that's going on. And that's the hardest thing to learn, how to rest. There's a spiritual Sabbath, and the Bible speaks of it. In fact, the Bible says that the Sabbath, there in Colossians, over there in Colossians, the second chapter, that the Sabbaths of the Old Testament were just shadows. A shadow is not the real thing. The word Sabbath is the word Shabbat, or several ways to spell it. Shabbat or Sabbat, S-A-B-O-T. Or in the New Testament, it is word sabbaton or sabbatismos, S-A-B-B-I-S-T-I-S-M-O-S. And there is a thing that we do on the Sabbath. It's actually not doing. It's not doing anything. And that's called rest. In the Old Testament, when the Bible speaks of the rest of the Sabbath, it is the word nuach, N-U-W. A-C-H, nuach. It means to desist from movement, don't do anything. In the Old Testament, the Sabbath, you couldn't do anything on the Sabbath. Now, people have really got the Sabbath all messed up because they think the Sabbath is something you do to go to church. You don't. When they had the Sabbath, when you look at that 16th chapter, if it's the very image over here, everything in the New Testament is the very image, and the Old Testament is the shadow. Shadow, there in Hebrews 10 and 1. The law having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image, cannot with all those sacrifices take away sins, the Bible says. Shadows the word skia. It is a shade. Skia means shade. It means if you go outside and you cast a shadow, that's not the real. You're the real. If I'm casting a shadow, you can't see my circulatory system, all my blood running through my body. You cannot see my respiratory system, my lungs, and my breathing. You don't see the real thing. The very image or the real is the New Testament. New Testament. And the word in the New Testament for Sabbath or rest. Now the rest is what we don't do on the Sabbath. It's something we do by not doing it. And in the New Testament, the term for resting on the Sabbath is kata pausis. And kata pausis comes from the word pause, pausis, P-A-U-S-I-S. Our word pause. When you pause, you stop everything. If you're on your computer and you hit pause, everything stops on the screen, and you're stopping. It means to stop and don't do anything about it. Now, what we're trying to see is that when we get involved in a battle, what do you mean a battle? You mean like going to war? Well, we're in a battle with family, acquaintances. You would call them friends, but they're not friends if they're not being obedient to God. We're not to have friends that do not obey God. Let me erase them songs there. And what we're trying to show people how to do, and you can't learn this one day, is when people attack you, when you're up against the wall with your bills, with your neighbors, with your family, because they don't like it because you don't believe in Christmas. Christmas is Christ Mass. And they want to get mad at you because you won't celebrate Christmas with them. Christmas is paganism. It has nothing to do with Jesus. They get angry at you because you believe in predestination. You tell them God doesn't love everybody. You're supposed to simply say it and believe it and not regard anyone's response. If they respond positive and they want to be a part of this, that's fine. But if they respond negative and want to make war with you, what you do is leave it alone, knowing that God works all things after the counsel of his own will. That includes evil. That includes all objections to you and your way of life. We're not supposed to ever get angry. We're not supposed to get mad at people. We're not supposed to get revenge. Revenge is mine, the Lord says. What we're supposed to do is what he says do, obey his word, not try to figure out how people respond to it. That's not our business. We simply tell them the truth. And you don't go around trying to beat people up with the truth. We realize that God is working all things after his own counsel and his own will. That's what Ephesians 1 and 11 says. We've obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to counsel of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will. If he's working everything, that means every time something comes up in your life, and whether it's some guy cutting you off in traffic, whether it's you don't have enough money to pay your bills, adjust yourself to where you can. Move down, step back. Don't say, I have to have that fancy car, I have to have that fancy house. Back away from everything where you can live and accept what God brings your way. The Bible says, in everything, give thanks. Does that mean these battles you fight, this worry you fight? Yes. In everything, give thanks and try to learn to accept everything that's happening from your enemies, from your friends. Not only are we to try to accept everything, we're try to help our friends in all of the troubles that they have. I have learned something as I grow older. If you can get over your selfishness and your greed and learn to help people that don't have, and they're believers, life becomes tolerable. It becomes more enjoyable. I have learned that. I had to learn to be free-hearted with people and to give to people. But you don't give to everybody. You give to those people who are believing. And somebody asked me the other day, said, well, the Bible says over in the 12th chapter of Romans that if a man is hungry, we give him something to eat. But then that has to balance with we withdraw from people who walk disorderly, people who bring another doctrine, we don't bid them Godspeed. If I see somebody hungry beside the road, something affects me more than anything else. If somebody is holding a sign, if the sign says, I've lost my house, I don't have a car, things like this, that doesn't affect me like if they're holding a sign that says, I'm hungry. That hits me every time. I'm hungry. I'll stop and say, let me take you down here and get you something to eat. I'm not going to give them money because they may spend it on cigarettes or booze, but I will buy somebody a meal. I have done that with people before. I'll go into a restaurant and say, give this man a lunch, and I'll pay for it now, drink and all, dessert, but it's not refundable. I do not want people to walk around hungry. Now, we got a lot of people in the world hungry. This is a long study on this, but if you're in a battle over your car note, over your house note, over your family, not believing truths about predestination. They want to do their Christmas. If you're in a battle, what you're supposed to do is what God says do without getting angry. Just do what He says to do. And if they refuse these doctrines, then the Bible says withdraw from them. If anyone brings another doctrine besides the Scripture, do not bid them Godspeed. That means to be cheerful to them. It don't mean to be angry and mean with them. Just back off. Let God work His counsel. Leave it alone. Don't you try to fix it. We're talking about this in the sense of resting in everything. You do the will of God in your life. If you struggle with that, call me and I'll help counsel you on that as to what to do. But you don't get angry. You don't support something that's false doctrine. You leave it alone. Anyone brings another doctrine, the Bible says, that's contrary to the doctrines you have learned, avoid these people. Just stay away from them. What if it's my mother? Stay away from her. Tell her the truth after the second admonition, then leave her alone. Leave her alone without being angry. Say, Mom, I can't go along with your beliefs. I couldn't go along with my mother's beliefs. My mother told me one time, she said, if you try to talk to me about predestination, I'll make you get out of the car and you'll have to walk. And she was driving at that time, and I was in my early 30s. I tried to talk to her about predestination. She refused to listen to anything I had to say. And she was a very gentle, quiet woman. And I've learned, as I grow older, let it happen. Just, it is what it is, and you're not going to change it. It took me till the last 10 years of my life to really begin to learn this. People will fight me. I will not fight them back. I refuse to. I refuse to defend myself. I let them. I've had people say, you did this and you did that. Oh, what did I do? Tell me what I did and I'll apologize for it, okay? Well, it's just you. You're just hard to get along with. Well, tell me what it is. And people don't know what to do with that. I'm real gentle with them when I say that. And I have had to learn that. I wasn't this way when I was 60. I wasn't this way when I was 55. Absolutely not. Wasn't this way. It's for sure I wasn't this way in my 40s because I was in real estate trying to battle everybody. The battle doesn't belong to us. It belongs to God in our lives. If we ever can come to that realization, what we'll do, we'll begin to rest in everything that's going on. Look, let me give you a couple of verses on this. This is real hard for Christians to get a hold of. Look over in Ecclesiastes. Go here to Ecclesiastes. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. And we'll get over here and we'll look at some verses here. And they need explaining because if you don't explain them, people don't know what this means. All right. In Ecclesiastes, I probably ought to read a little earlier than what I'm going to read because let me read to you back here in the third chapter. I was going to go to the ninth chapter. Let's go to the third chapter. Third chapter. Now, the birds years ago recorded a song. It was called Turn, Turn, Turn. And it used these words in their song. That was a rock group back in about 1970. And to everything there is a season, a time to every purpose under heaven. It's all God's purpose. For everything that happens, it's the will of God. There's a time to be born and a time to die. That's not a generalized time. The Bible says that it is appointed unto man, there in Hebrews, the fourth chapter, it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. The word appointed is the word apokimai, A-P-O-K-E-I-M-A-I. Now, chemai, this comes from apo and chemai, K-E-I-M-A-I. And that word chemai means to lay something out, lay out. Lay out like a track, like a train is on a track. There's a particular, apo means to set off. Set off. This timing, it's laid out. And everybody has an exact time to die. The day of my death, the exact second has been set from the foundation of the world. There's not one thing I can do for it or about it. You have a time that's already been set that you're going to die. Everybody has a time set. The Bible says that there's a time for every purpose here, and holds your place there, and we'll go back to Acts 17:26. I love this verse when it comes to timing for everything. This is probably my favorite verse in all the Bible because it lays everything out in an exact fashion. Here in Acts 17 and verse 26, "And God hath made of one blood," that would be Adam and Eve, "all nations of men for to dwell upon the face of the earth. And God has determined," now that word determined is the word horizo, O-R-I-Z-O. It's got that diacritical mark in front of it. It's like, huh. There's no H's in the Greek. There's this diacritical mark. When you find it, it has an H sound. Horizo. No H's in the Greek alphabet. But there is the breathing sound, the diacritical. D-I-A-C-R-I-T-I-C-A-L. It's a diacritical mark. Has a breathing sound. Horizo means to bound, but it's not merely just a regular boundary. Horizo is the word horizo, or horizon, means to determine a boundary line or a light. So he's determined the timing. That word time is the word kairos. K-A-I-R-O-S. He's determined the timing of everything, it says here. That word kairos is a word that means an exact place in time. He's determined the times, and they have been before appointed. The word before appointed is one word in the Greek. It's two words in the English. It's the word protasso, P-R-O-T-A-S-S-O. Protasso means before, pro is the prefix pre in our language. Tasso means to an arrangement. So God has before determined and prearranged the timing of all events. Good, bad, good and evil. God says, I make peace and create evil. I determine the death of every man. Jesus, there in the first chapter of Revelation, holds the keys of death and hell, not Satan. People say, Satan killed those people. No, Satan didn't kill anybody. God's got all deaths and all lives arranged, all good and all evil. And that's something most Calvinists won't preach. Say they believe in predestination. They want to spend some time on this verse. And God has predetermined. Now that word determined, horizo, it's an aorist, indicative verb. Anytime you see an aorist indicative, you can't just say that. You got to look it up in your interlinear Bible, get the exact spelling, and then go to an analytical lexicon, look the word up, and it have A-O-R-I-M-P. It means an IND means an aorist indicative. Now, the aorist indicative is a past tense verb. So since it's past tense, it makes that word determined, being past tense, pro. Horizo. Pro is our prefix pre, and pro horizo is the Greek word predestinate. When you find the word whom he did foreknow, whom, it's a people God foreknew, he predestinated them. So this word horizo in this verse, being an aorist indicative, you could translate it pro horizo or predestinate. So let's read it like that. God hath predestinated the timing of everything. The times they have been before appointed, protasso, prearranged ahead of time. The timing of everything has been prearranged. Everything's going to happen when God wants it to happen. Every negative thing in your life is happening, and it's happening for your good. And we know that all things work together for our good. So when you get into a fixed situation and you think, I'm here to stay the rest of my life and my whole life is going to be ruined, that's not true. Everything you're going through is for your benefit and for your welfare. That's what it's for. Well, I can't see that. Well, I couldn't see it in 1965, 66, 67, up through 72 and 73. I couldn't see anything working together for my good. I thought I was going to collapse and go into oblivion, but I didn't. That's why I'm here. God is working these things out for our good so he can refine us. He'll put us through everything and make us lose everything. I lost everything by the time I was 40. The property I own, the cars I own, this ministry, we're on TV in 200 towns and cities. I thought my life was over at 39. I thought I am never going to come out of this. But that wasn't true. Everything that God put me through was for my good because I was trying to be rich and famous back then. I wanted to be a famous singing star. I wanted to be a rich real estate mogul. And God had to take me through near-death experiences. I mean, I come right to death's door. And he's determined the timing of everything. It has been before appointed. Everything you go through as a believer has been appointed from the foundation of the world. That word appointed, kemai, means to lay out. It's the same word you see over there in 2 Thessalonians. I'll turn over there real quick. It's the same word, kemai, over in 2 Thessalonians. And look here in chapter 3, I believe it is. Chapter 3. And is this the chapter? Wait a minute. No, it's over here in... I haven't quoted this in a long time. But it says that no man should be moved by these afflictions, knowing that ye were appointed thereto. And we cannot be moved. The word moved is the word sio, S-A-I-O. We get the word seismograph. I don't know what I did. That I'm quoting it exact. Oh, yeah, here we are. In 1 Thessalonians 3:3, talking about all the things that Timothy's have, that the Thessalonians are having to go through. Verse 3, that no man should be moved by these afflictions. The word move, S-A-I-N-O, sino. S-A-I-N-O. Means to be shaken. Don't be shaken by the things you're going through. We get the word seismo from this, S-A-S-E-I-S-M-O. And we get the word seismograph from that. A seismograph is something that you measure the intensity of an earthquake, something that's shaking. He said, no man should be excessively shaken by these afflictions, T-H-L-I-S, thlipsis, L-I-P-S-I-S. Thlipsis is the word tribulation. It's a common word for tribulation. We must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. So no man should be shaken by these afflictions, knowing that ye were appointed thereto. The word appointed is the word chemi. It's the same word, apokemi, that it is appointed unto man once to die. You shouldn't be shaken by the afflictions you're going through, the struggles financially, because God is in charge of your life, and everything is happening the way God has ordained it, because He ordained all of these timing of everything. The timing in your life has to do with everything that's happened. God is not going to let His people sink. I thought it was all over when I was about... A guy called me to continue working in the music business, and I was about 37. And he said, I need you to come help me down here in this booking agency. And I said, I don't want to do that. He said, why? I said, I quit. He said, you quit what? I said, I quit life. I was at that point. I said, I quit life. He said, just come and help me. Well, I went down there and got to working with him. Got to producing a lot and moved off into real estate. I said, if I'm good at this, I must be good at that. And I was real good at real estate. But God wasn't through working on me. He put me in the hospital a bunch. For about 2 years, I was in and out constantly until God caused me to surrender to Him. And I was broke. I was flat broke. You ever been flat broke? I was flat broke at 40 years old. I went off to real estate school, started my life completely over again. And I still was worrying about everybody. I was worrying about the guys in real estate that were cheating and now operating in gray areas. And God had to get me in the hospital where I was saying, Lord, I give up. I surrender. I'm going to tell your truth, and I'm not going to pay any attention to what results comes. I'm going to tell all the truth all the time to everybody I can. I'm going to start with these doctors and nurses. And I was pulling my IVs around. I had them in each arm, and I was walking around the hospital preaching at the doctors and nurses. God brought me to a place of being serious, and what resulted of it was this ministry, and we're on TV all over America in about 200 different towns and cities, out in San Francisco and LA and up in Alaska and over in Hawaii and in Detroit and Chicago and up in St. Paul, Minnesota, and down in Texas, Dallas, Fort Worth, Houston, Beaumont, San Antonio, Austin, in all the boroughs of New York City, all up and down the East Coast. We're on in Philadelphia, and we're on in Boston, and in Washington, D.C., and Charleston, South Carolina, and Miami. All of that has happened, come about when I started saying, Lord, I'm going to do it all your way. And we started in my house with a class. And for about 5 years, we had 3, 4, 5 people. I just kept going, said, Lord, I'm going to do what you want. I was real sick. If you listen to some of my tapes, when I was 55, I'm coughing all the way through the messages. And now hardly ever cough. I'm not sick like I used to be. I stressed myself out till I was dying. And I did not learn to believe God till He just beat me in the head long enough to get my attention. And I started getting to feeling better in my 60s. I'm 77. I hardly ever cough. I don't have real serious bronchitis. I had bronchial asthma in the hospital. I had to learn to rest in everything that God was doing. You say, don't you have the problem? I get depressed looking at a world that don't believe God. I get depressed every day. And I've had to learn to believe God. The older I get, what am I going to do? Worry for the next 10 years and then die? Because I probably won't live much past 10 years. Maybe 12. If I live 12 more years, I'm going to be 90 years old. I can't see that. But I'm accepting everything that's going on in my life and everything that's really happening. All those years I wasn't being obedient to God and I was trying to be a famous singing star. All those years, it seems like a waste, but if I hadn't have gone through that, I wouldn't be here. I'm not worrying about anything. I don't stress over nothing. I don't stress when somebody starts a fight with me. I've had so many people, young preachers, think, well, it's time for me to take over Grace and Truth. Well, the Lord hadn't talked to me yet. You'll have to go away until he talks to me about that, okay? And I just laugh at things. Now, the things I used to worry about, I think a lot of them are funny. I used to want to fight people over them, but I don't want to fight nobody no more. Because I have learned who's in charge of the fight. Not me, not them, it's God. God raises up evil men to cut me down to keep me humble before him. That's what he's doing in your life. Now, go back over here to this Acts 17th chapter. God has determined the timing of everything, and they have been before appointed, prearranged by God. I don't care how bad it is. And there is a bound in the habitation of these things that are happening. That word bound is the word horothesia, H-O-R-O. T-H-E-S-I-A. It is a construction of horas and tithame. Tithame means to lay out. It is a very close kin in definition to chemai. It means to lay out or level out something. And horas, that's a common word. It's a derivative of the word horizo. It means a boundary, like on a coast, a boundary of a city or of a land. And that word bound, horothesia, means a limit. It means to limit. God has limited the timing of everything. And you can't go past what God has ordained. That's what he said in Job 14 and 5, that man's goings have been limited by God, and he can't go on the boundary that God hasn't ordained. So your life is not yours. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. And then he goes on to say, there's a habitation for the timing of all things. The word habitation is the word katokia. Katokia. O-I-K-I-A. You remember that word okia. O-I-K-I-A. O-I-K-O-S. It means a family. Or a place for a family to dwell. And it means to settle down. It has the idea of a housing. A housing, it's like a transmission has a housing. It abides within that metal covering. And it's around the transmission. And everything in the transmission has, it's like a computer. Everything within the computer has a place to operate. And when it don't operate right, you got to get somebody to come out and fix your computer or take it in and say, I'm not operating right. And everything has a housing around it. The Bible here says timing has a housing, and it's going to happen in the will of God the way he wants it to happen. That's what this is about. And a verse that goes with this is in Job. I want us to learn to accept whatever happens. God had to work on me tremendously to cause me to be willing to accept everything good and bad that was happening to me. And I defined a lot of things bad that wasn't really bad because, first of all, God was getting me out of what I was doing because what I was doing was bad for my health, bad for my life. God says, I'll make you so sick you cannot operate in this part of your life. And that's exactly what he did. And he caused me to be willing to accept everything that's happening. If you've been my enemy and you've tried to cause me trouble, you're wasting your time with me because I believe whatever you do to me is the will of God. And I have learned to accept it. That's what you need to learn. People that will lose their temper at me, you're wasting your time. I'm not going to respond to it. God has taught me that. In everything, give thanks. Now, go back over here to Ecclesiastes. Where was I? Chapter 3. So he says, there's a time to kill. There's a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant. Every farmer knows you plant things at the right time. Otherwise, and you plant them in the right way. God's planting everything in our lives the right way to bring about the fruit of the Spirit that we need to be bearing. If we're into ourselves and planting our lives ourselves, and trying to fight the battle ourselves by losing our temper and going off the deep end, that is not the way to grow. That's the wrong way to grow. If you really want to grow, submit to everything that happens and make every effort you can to do the things the way God says do it. Now he says there's a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up that which is planted. I've been doing a lot of that lately to my flowers. Winter's coming on, and it's not a time to have flowers trying to bloom. And you want to clean the ground up, clean it out, and get ready for next year. There's a time to kill and a time to heal. Now, only God knows. There's a time to kill, what, ants, roaches? Yeah, there is. And there's a time to kill people, but he does that. He knows when he wants to get. He said, I kill, I make alive, I wound, I heal. If somebody is healed, they're not healed by their faith. They're healed by the will of God. God has actually healed me. I didn't say, dear Lord, I pray for me and I pray to be healed right now. No. You'll be healed when you learn to rest and you're not putting your body under stress. I was coughing and hacking. I thought I was going to die before I was 50. I'm the best illustration I know of. I was one of the sickest men you can run across in my mid-40s. I was in and out of the hospital constantly. I'm never going to the hospital anymore. I very seldom have to go to the doctor anymore. I don't have to carry all that medication I used to carry. If I didn't have my little breathing apparatus and I got two blocks away from the house, I would have a nervous breakdown. If I was going to church, I'd have to drive back real fast and get those. I don't even care if I have one around. And if you've got real bad bronchial asthma, you say, I've got to have that no matter what. I don't have to have that anymore. I believe that God has healed me to a degree. You don't get totally healed. If you did, you wouldn't have more gray hair, no more wrinkles. We're all dying. I'm just dying slower than I was at 45. And everybody's dying. Gray hair proves that. Wrinkles prove that. Now, and he says there's a time to cast, there's a time to mourn, a time to weep, and a time to mourn, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, a time to dance. You dance, not you don't go down to the Starlight Club and dance. That's not what it means. You dance and you're joyful over things like David was when he danced around the Ark of the Covenant when he brought it back into Israel. A time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace. You can go to any number of things that this is talking about. A time to refrain from embracing. Well, one of the times to refrain from embracing is when somebody is preaching false doctrine, isn't it? The Bible says, withdraw from them. Don't go around them if they're preaching against the doctrines ye have learned, and avoid these people. Avoid ekklesia there in Romans 16, 17 means to pull away from them, lean away from them, make an effort to get out of their way. A time to get, a time to lose. There's a time to lose when what God wants you to get rid of all of your pride and your arrogance. This shouldn't be happening to me. Yes, it should. If you say this shouldn't be happening to me, it's time for it to be happening to you until you can come up and say, the Lord has bidden you to throw stones. Go ahead and throw stones. If you want to throw stones at me, go ahead, because God has bidden you to do that. A time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to rend and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, a time to speak. There's a time to love and a time to hate. David said, Lord, I want to hate those that you hate with a perfect hatred. Man, that sounds... God says, I hate all workers of iniquity. I do not like... I hate people like Kenneth Copeland who steals from the poor and the needy by saying, you need to send your money here and plant your seed here in order for you to get rich. That's a lie. That's like when a man steals from the poor and the downtrodden. I hate that man. And you're supposed to hate him too. God says, I hate workers of iniquity. There's a time to love, a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace. But when you're in war, let God do the fighting. Don't you come up and try to plan all the ways you're going to get back at your neighbor. And then he goes on down here and says, what profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which men hath given to the sons of men to be exercised by this, to be humbled. And men want to travail against others, and we're not supposed to be doing that. And then he says, he hath made everything beautiful in his time. Everything in our lives is going to be beautiful, even the hard things that we're going through. I don't think Ray Stevens knew anything about this when he wrote that song, Everything is Beautiful. It's only beautiful to those of us who are living for the Lord, and we have to learn that the bad things are for our good, and that's when they become beautiful in their time. Also, he hath set the world in their heart, so that no man can find out the work of God maketh from the beginning to the end. We can't figure this thing out. What he wants us to do is accept it. All the negative things. I know that there is no good in them, but for a man to rejoice and do good in his life. And also that every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. Don't sit around laying it all up and say, I got to put this all back for a rainy day. I know that whatsoever God doeth, which is everything, all this timing is of God. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it. Yasaph is the word. Added to it. Y-A-C-A-P-H. Nothing can be added to the work of God. Everything that's going on in our lives is the will of God, the good and the evil. He's doing the evil at the hands of evil man to stop us from doing things that we're doing so we can submit to him. That's a hard thing to get a hold of, isn't it? We're supposed to accept everything that's happening. It shall be forever, and nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. Put to it, that's the word gara, means subtracted from it. Everything that's going on, you can't add to it, you can't take from it, because it's the will of God, and God doeth it, doing it all. That's hard to get a hold of the fact that we go out here and get in our car and put the key in it and go out here and turn right or left and say, I'm making these decisions myself. No, you're not. God made them from the foundation of the world, and you are reacting according to what he put into your mind. If you turn right out here and you go down the street and have a wreck, is that the will of God? Not without the right turn. If you go take a left turn when you leave here tonight and you go down the street and you get a ticket, is that the will of God? Not without the left turn. If you go down the street and it's raining and you slide into a ditch, is that the will of God? Not without that turn. Everything that's going, I really believe people will say, that makes us robots. You bet your life it does. And what does it make God in our life? Total God. He is complete God. If men would preach this rather than say, well, that makes us robots. I don't think we're robots. I think we got a choice to do things. No, you don't. The Bible says it's not the will of man, but it's of God. So then, it is God's will that causes everything to happen. I don't see how God could create anything without creating everything it's going to do. Because if there's a glitch in that thing that he creates, he put the glitch there. Was there a glitch in Satan when God made him? Well, yeah. Who made sure there was a glitch? Because Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Look over in Ezekiel. Look at Ezekiel. The 28th chapter, Ezekiel. Now, this is talking about... Oh, goodness. I'm getting down to territory I probably didn't want to get into tonight. It's talking about Satan, but it's talking about the Prince of Tyre. There in chapter 28, the word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the Prince of Tyre. The Prince of Tyre was just above Israel, and his daughter was Jezebel. And here's the Mediterranean Sea. Here's Egypt down here, going down that way. Here's the Sinai Peninsula. Here's Israel. And here's Tyre right up here. Well, the Prince of Tyre kept the fire worship going, and there his daughter was Jezebel. And he says, because, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. This is not talking, that shouldn't be a capital G. It should be a little G in your Bible. A capital G means Jehovah God. He wasn't saying, I'm Jehovah God. He was saying, I am a little G-O-D. I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas. That sounds like so much talking. He was in the midst of the seas because Tyre was a city, and it was a little island off of the coast of what we would, the ancient world would call Phoenicia. And when Alexander the Great came down here to conquer Tyre, he had to build a little road made with stones out there to conquer Tyre. So Tyre dwelt in the midst of the seas. Actually, you can look at an old map and it'll show you that. I dwell in the midst of the seas. I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas. Yet thou art a man and not God. You're a man. You are the Prince of Tyre. And though thou set thine heart as the heart of God. Now, go on down here, and it's going to tell us more about this Prince of Tyre. Look here in verse 11. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyre, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and beauty and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Well, this is very abstract language. The Prince of Tyre was in Eden, the garden of God, in the form of Satan, who took upon himself to be the God of the garden. So this was a transition in, it's simply the spirit that was in the serpent in the garden is in the Prince of Tyre. It's in also in Babylon that said, let us make us a name. And then he says, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Now, I went into this in detail in a Revelation series I taught, but I'm not going to go into it now. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. And I have set thee. God says, I set you in this manner. And he's talking about Satan being in a man in the sense that he was the head of the fire worship of Tyre. Well, that's not, he wasn't anointed with the Spirit of God. What verse are you talking about? Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. But he wasn't anointed with the Holy Spirit, with truth, Dave. Anoint just means to cover in this text here. Because watch what it says. I have set thee, so thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect, not perfect in the sense of being without sin. It says here, thou wast perfect in the ways from the day that thou wast created. This was a created being here. Till iniquity was found in thee. Now, who made sure that iniquity was found in Satan? God put that there. It was a glitch in him. And he goes on to say, by the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore, I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God. I will destroy thee, O covering cherub. He's covered with his own pride. It's just like Isaiah 30 and 1 says, you're covered with a covering, but not of my spirit. He was covered with his own pride. This is a picture of Satan, but it's actually the Prince of Tyre. The two systems that kept the fire worship going was Tyre and Babylon. And the Prince of Tyre, according to the writers, Ethbaal, was a priest of the Babylon. He was a priest of Baal and a priest of Ashtaroth, the tree deities. This is simply a transcending of one person being dwelling in another. It's simply the spirit of Satan dwelling in the Prince of Tyre. But God says, I put the glitch in this being. You were in the garden with God. That's what he says in verse 13. But I put this sin in you. If God hadn't wanted Satan to have sin in him, we would never had sin in the world. If God hadn't put the glitch in Satan, he wanted it there. God wanted sin to happen. And then he wanted to be angry at it. Right? If he hadn't have wanted sin to happen, he wouldn't have created Satan this way, and our names wouldn't have been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, and Jesus wouldn't have been the lamb slain from the foundation of the world for the sin of mankind. Not all mankind, but just for his elect. I'll come back and talk about this some more. Point I was getting at. Satan had a glitch in him when he was in heaven, and he was perfect. The word perfect, tamim, T-A-M-M-I-Y-M. Means he was upright until sin was found in him. Why did he have sin in him? He had sin in him because God wanted it there. That will really bother most people. What do you mean God wanted sin to happen? It had to happen for God to have redeemed a people that he had chosen before the foundation of the world, didn't it? If God had not wanted sin to happen, would it have happened? And Adam and Eve would have been lived perfect and lived forever, and there wouldn't have been no me and no you. There wouldn't be no Gentiles coming to the truth. The point being, God wanted this imperfection in Satan, and it was found in him, and it was manifested throughout the world in this fire and tree worship, which was started in Babylon. God wanted it. If our names are written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, before we were born, God had to make sure sin would be here, and then he would be angry at it. The point I'm getting at, even the sin God ordained, and then he's angry at it when he creates it. I keep saying this. If there is no down, there is no up. If there is no sour, there is no sweet. If there's no bitter, there's no sweet. You can't call something sweet if bitter had never been invented, could you? What would you call sweet? If everything was sweet and there was no bitter and no sour, what would you call sweet? Have no definition, would it? Because you never tasted sour or bitter before. So if you're going to have mercy, it has to be placed in opposition to something. It has to be placed in opposition to God's wrath, God's judgment. If God has wrath, he has to create it, and he has to want it. There's nothing out there going on that God hasn't done. He said, I make peace and create evil. I bring all this evil upon Israel. He said there in Jeremiah 32:32, God tells Jeremiah, because of all the evil that they have provoked me to anger. And he's, but if they have evil, God has to create it, because he said, I create the evil that's in man. There's nothing going on. The timing of everything is set. Now let's go over here to Ecclesiastes. Go to Ecclesiastes. I'm not getting where I wanted to go tonight. There's so much to this. I'd have to go to the 14th chapter of Isaiah, which is going to show us that Belshazzar is I just lost my thought process. Lucifer. Lucifer is mentioned one time in the Bible. Halil is the word. We get the word halal from hallelujah. It means the glory. The glory belongs not to Belshazzar. It belongs to God. And he was the last king of Babylon. God destroyed him for being this proud man. Now, let's go over here to Ecclesiastes. What I'm wanting to get over to people, and I can't get it over to you unless God gets it over to you, I can't. Look at 9 verse 11, Ecclesiastes. I returned and saw under the sun, verse 11, that the race is not to the swift. It doesn't matter how fast you run. You're not going to win because you run faster than anybody else. You're just not going to win because of that. The race is not to the swift, nor the battle is not to the strong. It's not matter how strong you are. It doesn't matter how good you are at something. It's going to be up to God as to who wins. Neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding. That's not who comes up with riches. Donald Trump didn't come up with riches because he was wealthy, because he was real smart. I looked him up months ago on the internet, and it says on the internet that his grandfather owned a corporation. Gosh, if my grandfather owned a corporation and left it to me, I couldn't be richer too. I'm not putting him down. He probably has a lot of good business acumen, but he got it from his parents. His daughter, in a documentary, Donald Trump's daughter, I saw her in this documentary, and she's looking out over New York, and she said, my grandfather built this, not my father. And she said, I'm going to build me a building just like my grandfather built these. Well, that's a little bit of a con to put on the American public to say, I did all this production that I'm doing. No, your parents' money did it. Now, you may be a good businessman, but you didn't do it. See, people want to take glory for something they didn't do. Nor yet favor to men of skill. This says it don't matter how good you are, but time, in God's time, chance happeneth to them all. Well, that sounds like accident happens to them all. That word chance is not our word chance. It is the word paga. The New Testament word, it is the word intercession. Now, intercession is not always good the way we look at it. It means to impinge or to stop progress. means to impinge progress. If you're going along, the best way to describe intercession, it's the word E-N-T-U-G-C-H-A-N-O in the Greek. And they have the same meaning. It means to stop something from continuing in a certain direction. It's like if you are going to, if you're driving a car and you're coming up to this intersection. I can't draw cars. Here you are in this car. Coming up to this intersection. We're going to make the hood this way. And you're headed toward that intersection, and you see a little girl walking out across the, and she's going to walk across this street, and you see a car coming from this direction, speeding at a breakneck speed, driving 100 miles an hour, and you see it's going to hit that little girl. You go over here and you hit that car and knock that car off in another direction. That is intercession. Sometimes when we're going along and we, here we are in our life, we're trying to get rich. We're trying to have our way with money and fame and fortune, like that's what I was doing. And I was real capable of doing it. I was real good in business. I analyzed everything. And I would work like crazy. Let me tell you what. There's a secret to getting rich. You have to work 90 hours a week. And I did that. It was just work, 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 work. I never stopped. I got that secret to tell people if they won't tell nobody. That's the way you make a living. You don't ever, I tell young people, when you get out of a job, you look, 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 and you just don't stop looking. You go and apply everywhere you can, and something will happen. Well, that's impinging progress. Well, if you're going along in life, and God says, I don't want you this to happen to you, I'm going to knock you off that path, and you're going to go over here and take another path. That's the way God works. Let me show you. Look in Hosea. Hosea. God is going to intercede. Sometimes the interceding is not the way we like it. This is a real good illustration of not liking God's impingement or his pagah or his intuncano in the New Testament. Look here in Hosea. Now when Israel, I can't get off the same subject. When Israel kept going after Baal in the grove and Chemosh and Molech, and all of these gods, these fire gods, all the time they were a nation under kings from Saul to Zedekiah, the last king, 1 Samuel through 2 Chronicles, while they were under the rule of kings in the Old Testament, God is reprimanding them through Hosea. And he says, look at verse 1. When Ephraim spake trembling, he exalted himself in Israel when he offended in Baal. Ephraim is northern Israel. Baal was the sun god. And the way northern Israel got involved in the sun god was through their king Ahab, and that's how they offended in Baal. When Ahab marries Jezebel and brings her gods down into Israel, he offends in Baal. And now they sin more and more. And Ephraim is the second-born son of Joseph. And Joseph received the inheritance of Israel through his second-born son, Ephraim. And you'll find God bringing judgment on Ephraim or the 10 northern tribes. That was Ephraim or Joseph. And then he goes on down here. Now, see, we're still in the same subject we're in on Sunday morning, aren't we? I don't even have to review that with the people that are here. Now they sin more and more, and they made them molten images of their silver and idols according to their own understanding. Everybody understands this, don't we? We've heard this too much, haven't we? Israel going after Baal in the grove. their idols. And it's the same thing as Christmas. And all of it, the work of the craftsman, he's talking about them making these idols. And I have circled in green everywhere it says Ephraim through my Bible. And he is all over northern Israel, Hosea is, after northern Israel, for all that they did. See all those green circles in my Bible? That's all attacking on Ephraim, northern Israel, for Ahab bringing all this idol worship into Israel. So we're not in a different subject here than we were in 2 Kings last Sunday morning. We're not in a different subject than we are in Jeremiah when he's prophesying against Israel for going after these gods. And then he goes on down here and says, I don't want to read all this. Let me just read some of it. Verse 4, yet I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt, and thou shalt know no God but me, for there is no Savior beside me. Well, who is the Savior of the church? Does anybody know? It's Jesus. Jesus is the I Am of the Old Testament. He said he was before Abraham was I Am. Then he said, I did know thee in the wilderness, in the land of great drought, according to their pastures, so were they filled. They were filled and their heart was exalted. Therefore they have forgotten me. This is God telling Israel, you've forgotten me. And Hosea is pronouncing judgment against northern Israel. Therefore I will be unto them as a lion, Babylon, the Babylonian lion. That's the beast. As a leopard, the Grecian leopard. By the way, will I observe them? I will meet them as a bear. Persia. The word meet. This is not a good feeling. The word meet here is the word paga. I will intercede against Israel as the Persian bear in it's the beast, the Persian bear, in Daniel, the 7th chapter, and Revelation, the 13th chapter. When God meets him as a bear, he's going to meet him as Persia, the beast. When he meets him as a lion, he's going to meet him as Babylon and come in and slaughter him at the hands of Nebuchadnezzar. That's the way our life comes about. When we've been going after Babylon, going after, let us make us a name, God says, I will meet you as a lion, a bear, and a leopard. I will intercede. I will send all of this in your life, and you'll think it's all evil. And God says, I've got to get you off the track you're on. I have to impinge your progress down this path of sin because you're my elect. And I'm going to stop you from running into this situation over here. That's what our lives are about. We have to learn that all the evil is to knock us off the course we're on. Because if God lets you have your way, that ain't going to work. The battle is not to the strong. Bread is not to those that are wise. It's to those, it's going to have to be the impingement of God in your life. It's not because of your wisdom that you're going to do the right thing. It's not because you're the fastest runner. It has nothing to do with that. Probably one of the best illustrations of that, back years ago, the Seattle Seahawks had a wide receiver. And what was his name, the guy that couldn't run fast? Huh? Steve Largent. Steve Largent was a slow runner. He wasn't particularly great at anything he did, except one thing. He could get open. He could just get where the ball was. How he did it, nobody knows. He was second only for years as far as receptions behind, what's his name with the, huh?
Rice.
Yeah, Rice. He is second only to Rice in receptions. He just knew how to get open. It wasn't because he was the fastest. Wasn't it because he was the slickest? He just could read the line and get open, and they could throw him the ball. It's real simple. Our lives are that same way. It's whatever God gifts us and what he makes us stop doing by putting all the evil in his life. I wouldn't have stopped trying to sing. I had an excellent voice. I hit these high notes and shake the whole auditorium. I was real good in business. I could hustle. But God stopped me from doing all of that. And I started doing this. I'd been doing this when I was a young preacher in my 20s, and I wandered off into the world. God says, you're not going to get by with this. I'll make you so sick you'll be wishing you're dead if I don't kill you. All those bad things are to impinge our progress to our destruction. God says, you're my elect. You're going to conform. I predestined you to conform to my likeness. And you're going to do it, and this is not a matter of whether you want to. It has nothing to do with your will. I will break your will. He's got the whole thing planned. I've been as sick as a man can be without dying. Right at the door. God had to teach me some things. I like to tell the congregation that, so you won't think, well, Jim's different than us. No, I'm not. And neither is anybody else. If God wants a man to serve him, he will have to break him. A broken and a contrite heart thou wilt not despise, David said in that 51st Psalm. God will break your heart. He'll break your heart over your sin. And he'll stop every one of his people from doing what they're doing and make them go the right direction. He knows how to do that. Now, so he says, I'll meet you as a bear that's bereaved of her whelps. There's the lion, the bear, and the leopard. There's Babylon, Persia, Greece. And that was not something that felt good to Israel. God slaughtered them by the millions. And he's going to do that till the end of time. Now go back over here to Ecclesiastes. He says, I returned and saw under the sun. I'm going to read that again. That the race is not to the swift. It's kind of like the tortoise and the hare, you know? The hare says, I'm so fast, I can go over here and sit down and relax. And the tortoise just keeps going until it wins the race. Nor the battle to the strong. Our battles have nothing to do with us winning. It has to do with God winning. Let me show you something. I've got some places I was going to go, and I don't know if I can get there. How much time do I have, Mike? Let's go over here to 2 Chronicles. I wanted to read this Sunday morning, but I never got around to it. We've been talking about Jehoshaphat on Sunday morning. Now, you're in a battle. Put yourself in this, okay? I may come back and finish up the rest of it. 2 Chronicles 20. You've heard me say that Jehoshaphat was a good man. He just had one problem. He ran around with Ahab, who was a wicked king. And let me erase this. And Israel was always at war with Ammon and Moab. Ammon and Moab were two nations. They were right east of Israel. And what's east of Israel today is Jordan, the land of Jordan. And you've got, let me see if I can get it over here on the map. Let me see here. Well, that's not a good map there. Well, right here. You see this, looks like a little handle up here, Jordan. This is Jordan. Here's Israel right here. Jordan was made up of Moab, that's southern Jordan. The land of Ammon was northern Jordan. Looked like a handle. This is, let me see here. Like so. This would be Jordan. Something like that anyway. Something like that. And Israel is right here. Well, Moab was southern Jordan. And this is Israel. Here's the Mediterranean Sea. That's awful fat Israel. It had to be like this. Like so. And this would be Tyre or ancient Phoenicia, what we call Lebanon. And Moab and Ammon. And Moab and Ammon were always fighting Israel. They're right there next door. Now, Ammon was the son of Lot. And Moab was the son of Lot, the oldest son of Lot. And when they came out of, right below Israel, is Sodom. When they came out of Israel, out of Sodom, that's where they were delivered by the angel from Sodom. And Lot's wife looked back and she's turned into a pillar of salt and it killed her. God commanded him not to do that. Well, his daughters took Lot into a high mountain, took him into a cave, and both of them had a son by their father. This wasn't for sexual reasons. It was because God had promised a Messiah that would come out of Abraham. Well, Lot evidently thought that it might come from him. So his daughters had sons, and the sons of Lot, who was the nephew of Abraham, was Moab and Ben-Ami, Ben-A-M-M-I. Well, the land of Ammon, they get that from Ami. And the Ammon, Jordan, is the capital of Jordan today. Well, they were always at war with Israel. And at the time, Jehoshaphat is the king of Israel here. And Moab and Ammon declare war against Israel. Verse 1, it came to pass after this also that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon and with them others beside the Ammonites came against Jehoshaphat in southern Judah. He's the king of southern Judah, to battle. Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there comes a great multitude against you. Now, this is a picture of our life. There's a great multitude that comes against us in life. A lot of them are vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. Some of them are immature believers that want to battle us and want to fight us. Some is our bills. Some is our jobs. Everything that would stir you up, this should stir up Jehoshaphat. There cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side of Syria. And behold, they be in Hazazon-Tamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord. When you're afraid in life, you need to seek the Lord and then follow his instructions. Don't get overly angry. Don't get revenge. Say, Lord, I'm going to trust you to guide me in life. And follow his instructions. Don't get involved in your orge, your revenge. That's the revenge of covetousness. Somebody's trying to get what you've got because they want it. Don't do that. Jehoshaphat was going to face a tremendous opposition. And Judah gathered themselves together. Of course, Jehoshaphat is the king of Judah. To ask help of the Lord. That's what we do. We don't take it upon ourselves to fight our own battles. The battle is not to the swift nor to the strong. If it was, Ammon and Moab and all of their helpers are going to conquer Judah, even out of the city of Judah they came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, now here's a prayer of Jehoshaphat, O Lord God of our fathers, art not thou God of the heaven, and rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of heaven? And in thine hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand you? They're not praying for themselves. They're doing the same thing that Asa did in the 22nd chapter, 1 Chronicles. Asa had to go up against 1 million Ethiopians, and he only had 500,000. And the Ethiopians had chariots of iron. They had those with those scythes on the wheels. The Ethiopians should have slaughtered Israel. But Asa prayed a prayer just like this. He said, Lord, let not man prevail against thee. He didn't say me. What you need to learn, and I need to, I want to learn as much as I can. In my prayers, I need to say, Lord, let not men prevail against thee. But you see, God has a different way of fighting the enemy than we do. He knows what to do when you're up against the wall and you say, I can't pay my bills, I don't have the job I need, I got my family's mad at me. Follow the instruction of God. Rest. Art not thou our God, who he's still praying, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham thy friend forever? Here's Jehoshaphat's prayer, great prayer. And they dwelt therein and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying, if when evil cometh upon us as a sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before this house, and in thy presence we're going to lean on you. That's what we need to learn, because God has ordained everything to be the way it is. Why don't we just trust him rather than ourselves? I'll get that guy back. Don't get anybody. If God wants them gotten, he'll get them. For thy name is in this house, and crying to thee in our affliction, then thou wilt hear and help. And now behold, the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, which is the home of the Moab, whom thou wouldest not let Israel invade when they came out of the land of Egypt, but they turned from them and destroyed them not. Behold, I say, how they reward us to come and cast us out of thy possession, which thou hast given us to inherit. O our God, wilt thou not judge them? For we have no might against so great a company that comes against us. We have no ability to whip them. I don't have any ability to pay my bills. I don't have ability to get the job I need. I have ability to overcome my sickness. Neither know we what to do. We don't know what to do. Sounds like us, doesn't it? I don't know what to do, Lord. He said, I've arranged everything. I've arranged the battle. Just sit back and see the power of the Lord take hold. But our eyes are upon thee. Boy, that's a great prayer, isn't it? We need to learn. Predestination's true. God's ordained all things. He's ordained the good and the evil. You say, I don't like the way I look. I don't look good enough to get the kind of job I need. I don't have the success. He said, it's not your success. It's not your might nor your power. He said, it is by the will of God that things will happen. And he's already ordained it and assigned it before the foundation of the world. It's all of those things in Acts 17:26, that he's ordained the timing of everything. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. Then upon Jahaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jeel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. The Spirit of the Lord is truth. And he said, this is godly, righteous man that stands up amidst the Israelites. Hearken ye all, Judah, ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, And thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude. And I love the last part of this sentence. For the battle is not yours, but God's. Let me say that to the people that are watching this. It's not your battle. It belongs to the Lord. And He'll end it the way He wants it to end. I could never have foreseen having a ministry preaching predestination. And God doesn't love everybody all over the country. There's not many that respond, just the few that Jesus talked about. Fear not, little flock. Just the few of that enter into the narrow way. The battle is not yours, but God's. Boy, isn't that a great prayer to pray? It's not my battle, Lord. You've had this thing ordained before the foundation of the world. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. Ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. You don't need to fight. You need to rest. God has got this thing laid out, hasn't He? Why don't we believe Him? He says that from one end of this book to the other. Do I have any time, Mike? See the salvation of the Lord with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. Go out in the world tomorrow. Don't attack them. Don't defend yourself. Don't try to get revenge. Don't try to get back at people. God has got it arranged. He'll get who He wants to get. Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Israel fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And the Levites of the children of Kohathites and the children of Korahites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high while they were facing their enemies. That's what I'm challenging you to do. Go face your enemy knowing that the timing of everything has been arranged. What is going to happen in the future has been arranged. And they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, here's Jehoshaphat's prayer again. Hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe His prophets, so shall ye prosper. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness. He didn't appoint an entertainment committee. Everybody get out there and shout and get glory for themselves. And as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for His mercy endureth forever. And when they began to sing and praise the Lord, set ambushments. God showed them how to ambush these people against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir. It doesn't look like God likes the children of Ammon or the children of Moab, does He? Don't love everybody. Which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. For the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir. Mount Seir is the same as Moab. Utterly to slay and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped to destroy another. And when Judah came toward the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked unto the multitude, and behold, they were dead bodies fallen to the earth, and none escaped. And they were outnumbered. And your enemies outnumber you, unless God fights for you. God has a way of fighting for us. He had a way of fighting for me. You know what He fought for? He didn't fight for the old Jim Brown. He fought for this Jim Brown. He wanted to get rid of the old Jim Brown, the one that wanted to sing and be famous. So what he did, he fought my enemy. You know who my enemy was? Me. I was trying to destroy all the work of God by seeking myself, by saying, I will make up my own doctrine, my own name. Let me make me a name. When Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoil of them, they found among them in abundance both riches with the dead bodies, precious jewels, which they stripped off of themselves more than they could carry away. And there were 3 days in gathering of the spoil. It was so much. I can't believe what God has done to my life. I can't believe how he's caused this ministry to prosper, how we're reaching people all over the world. I didn't start a ministry. This is what some young people come here, they don't understand. God had to convince me to preach predestination because I hid it for a lot of years. I'd preach it in a sense of an arrangement where I wouldn't mention the word. I was scared. I knew preachers didn't like it. I thought I'll be out here in the middle of Clovis, New Mexico, and some preacher will throw me out of his church because I'm preaching on it. And they said, we don't have that here. That's exactly what would have happened. God has overwhelmingly blessed this ministry. We're reaching elect people from all over the world through the internet. We stream 24 hours a day. You can go on the internet and watch any number of 500 messages that we've got on the internet. I never thought it would happen because I was trying to do things my way. God had to destroy my enemy, which was me. And on the fourth day, they assembled themselves in the valley of Berakah, and there they blessed the Lord. Therefore, the name of the place was called the Valley of Berakah unto this day. Then they returned, every man of Judah and Jerusalem, and Jehoshaphat in the forefront of them, to go again to Jerusalem with joy, for the Lord made them to rejoice over their enemies. And let me get on down here. And they came to Jerusalem with psalteries and harps and trumpets in the house of the Lord. And the fear of God was on all the kingdoms of those countries when they had heard that the Lord fought against the enemies of Israel. So the realm of Jehoshaphat was quiet, for his God gave him nuach, rest. Spiritual Sabbath, spiritual rest in the land. That word nuach is the same word that's used for the rest of the Sabbath in the 20th chapter of Exodus, in the Ten Commandments. God gave him spiritual rest. The whole point is, you want rest against all of your opponents and your enemies in life? Trust God, not yourself, to fix it. That is the rest of God. But it's great, isn't it, to get all the way through this. And they had rest round about. I'm going to come back to this rest in the Old Testament. Am I out of time? I was waiting. That's kind of like, that's the hammer that hit at the end. God gave them rest against their enemies. God will give you and me rest. I have learned this. God has given me rest against everyone that would destroy me. I quit trusting me and I don't try to fight them. I just keep preaching. I don't get angry. I used to get angry at everything. I don't ever get angry anymore. When somebody accuses me of things, calls me names, says all this, I say, well, you're throwing stones and I deserve everything you're throwing at me for the way I lived and when I was off in my sin, seeking self. Just keep throwing stones. God will stop you when he's ready. God stopped Shimei from throwing stones, put him under the rule of Solomon, and Solomon finally had to kill him. All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for your truth. Thank you for showing us the rest that we need is to cease self and quit trying to remedy our situation. Just keep doing what you said to do. We'll praise you for all things. Fight our battles. We keep praying that. You fight them. I'm not going to fight them. That's what David said. Plead my cause. Fight for me. We can't fight our way out of this. We're in it to live in it to the end. We'll praise you for all things in Christ's name. Amen. Boy, I love that chapter. I meant to bring it out Sunday, but I just didn't want to hold off. It came in handy here about resting.
We ought to send that out to every TV station. I mean,
trying to get people to understand God's fighting our battle for us.
We ought to just send it out to the church. We'll play this Sunday.
Well, I doubt if they will.
But I've had, seriously, the reason I asked you about the anointed cherub, because I've had like two people call me up and go, see, Satan's going to heaven. And I go, no, he's going to be cast into the lake of fire. And that's not...
Well, it's like Isaiah 30:1 says, they were covered with a covering, but not of my spirit.
Right, there you go.
Thanks for saying that. It's Well, I love that chapter about Jehoshaphat, because he couldn't fight his enemies. I mean, you can't fight this colon thing you got.
No.
You got to say, Lord, it's yours. You want to kill me with it? Fine.
That's why he's got that death angel that just came over all those 85,000
that's right.
people and killed them.
That's right.
That didn't even have to go
God out. Knows how to fight our battles,
wow, that's
doesn't
crazy.
He?
Yeah. And to
he knows how.
Yeah, I love those chapters.
I'm glad you can see that.
Yeah.
I love you, man. That is great, though, isn't it?
No, it's unbelievable. That's one. I mean, Jehoshaphat's probably losing sleep, and then he wakes up and goes... They're all dead.
Yeah.
What happened?
Well, it was scaring Hezekiah the king. And Isaiah the prophet
Hezekiah.
He told him, he was scaring him, and he said, you go home, you rest, you go to sleep, God's taking care of this. God's taking care of us.
I get Hezekiah and Jehoshaphat mixed up.
Oh, that's all right. That's all right. It's great to understand that you don't have to fix yourself.
Yeah.
David said, my heart is fixed.
Wow.
It's already fixed. We don't have to worry about what we look like, how tall we are, how short we are, how good looking we are. Somebody's outdoing us because they're better looking. Well, Donald Trump's got a whole stage full of handsome, beautiful people. All of his daughters are gorgeous. He was married to three beautiful women. He's got a beautiful woman. I don't know why they all divorced him. I don't know. I don't understand. And he's got all these beautiful kids, and they're going to die in their sin and go to hell.
He's probably a jerk.
That don't mean anything.
But the one I'm getting from his whole thing is predestination. Everything that you talk is predestination.
Everything is.
That's why preachers don't preach it, because they can't get your money.
Yeah.
If they tell you that you're not in control, they're trying to get you to think that you're in control of your
money. Of your money. They're trying to get you to believe it. You're in control of your money.
It's his money. Cause
that's right.
If earth is as strong, and I mean, if heaven is as strong, earth is as footstool, that's his money. How you doing, guy? Superman.
Give me a hug. I love you, Dennis.
All the time.
Huh?
I love coming here.
I love this message. Sometimes I don't feel like preaching. I got into this night and I didn't want to stop.
I'm glad you do.
But God has ordained your life. It's going the way it's supposed to go. You're not supposed to try to fix it.
That's what it is, a Sabbath.
You go the way God lets it go. Don't try to fix people.
Nope.
Just be the good guy that you're supposed to be, godly, righteous man you're supposed to be. That's all you're supposed to be. You can't fix your life or anybody else's. You can live the way you're supposed to live. And that's all you can do.
Does it make you do it, and that make you feel that you're in control, then you might as well be a God.
Yeah. Well, that's what you are. If you're controlling, God lets those people out in the world progress the way they're progressing. He lets them do that. Mm-hmm. Because the 73rd Psalm says, I was envious of the wicked. Because there was no bands in their living death. that nothing kept restraining them. Their eyes, what their eyes saw, they went after and they got it. Mm-hmm. And David said, I didn't understand all this till I saw their end. And when you see their end, it's not going to be good. Those that are elect, God's fixed our lives. He's fighting the battle. Don't try to fight it. Don't try to fix it in any way. That's going to be a long time until you come to that. Because you keep trying to fix everything. I quit trying to fix things. It's been slowly coming. But I quit trying to fix people. Quit trying to, if they get mad, I say, well, there they go. Let's get back to work. I don't get mad at people anymore. I used to get mad all the time. All the time. Even in my 50s. But I'm not going to do that no more. God has got our lives arranged. That's why predestination is so important. So people can see that this is all of God.
And I think when you get mad at people, you're angry at yourself.
Well, you're because you can't have what you want. It boils down to that.
It's like you telling him, "You couldn't, don't go out there because I couldn't go out there."
Yeah.
Now, if you get,
I love you guys.
I don't get. If you get it,
catch your legs. If you pay and marry for it,
and I don't get it.
Hey, Mike.
Have a wreck.
I'm John. I'll say hello. I didn't have my phone with me, so.
Yeah, tell him when you get home. We get mad. So still be up, baby.
God, because God doesn't see us that everything. God is ordained it all. We are what we are. We are where we are because it's what we're supposed to be. If we haven't completely developed yet, we will.
I'm an elect, and I'm going through.
It's what that means.
20 years ago.
Yeah.
There are people that want what they want. They get revenge. I'll get them. I'll have what I want. What God wants. Yeah. Like I said, there's Donald Trump. He's a winner. In this world, he's a winner. With God, he's a loser.
Yeah. Gotta make some more of these.
Man, that'll win here. He's gonna lose his soul to death. All
right.
He's got a purpose.
Working. And he's here for a purpose.
He's not a fail.
It'd be all right if it was left.
If you had that much money,
very bad.
You can have what you
want.
Yeah, right.
He has these young girls as his wife.
That's a long out and drag out.
That's why they're married, isn't it?
You make the notes and cut them out.
But they have everything they want the rest of their life. It works.
Except truth.
Except truth, and then you have to go to hell.
Lord, I thank thee, Father, that was hidden this from the wise and prudent.
Yeah, Mama.
Reveal them unto babes. Bye, y'all.
Bye.
See you.
Bye. Bye. Love you guys.
Careful.
That's life, isn't it?
Superman, what are you doing?
Dun, 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 dun. He's well.
All right.
Oh, man, I've been doing it, Mike.
You mean?
Yes, sir. Which is nothing.
Well,
God doing it all.
That's hard for young. That message is hard for young people to understand, but you will understand.
I like that rest. Yeah.